Okay, hi everyone. I'm Samin Vizier. I'm in the psychology department here at UC Davis, and I will be moderating the first session, which is on defining the issues, research on replication, reproducibility, and transparency. And the goal of this first session is going to be kind of to set the stage for the rest of the day and discuss where we're at in terms of replicability in the social sciences. So our first speaker is Garret Christensen. And Garret Christensen is a data science fellow at the Berkeley Institute for Data Science and staff scientist with the Berkeley Initiative for Transparency in the Social Sciences, a program of UC Berkeley's Center for Effective Global Action. He received his PhD in economics at UC Berkeley in 2011 and has since conducted research on the WASH Benefits Public Health Randomized Trial for Innovations for Poverty Action and Emory University and has taught economics at Swarthmore College. He's interested in research transparency and reproducibility and questions of causal inference in labor and development economics, particularly with regard to child health and education programs in both developed and developing country settings. He has also run more than 50 ultramarathons and walked from border to border across the entire United States 4 complete times. So please join me in welcoming Garret Christensen.
Hi, everybody. Samin, we've got 20 minutes each, the three of us, or something like that. Okay. So I will introduce you to sort of the problems of publication bias and p-hacking and a potential solution in the form of pre-registration. So sort of to introduce this whole thing, I like to frame this quest. So I'll introduce I like to frame this in terms of transparent research being ethical research. I'll talk about registrations and pre-analysis plans. So I'm from BITS, which is at UC Berkeley, the Berkeley Initiative for Transparency in the Social Sciences. We're one of several organizations that have been built up in the last few years that are trying to increase transparency in research, particularly just across the social sciences. And we're happy to be here today. So I view transparency as part of being an ethical researcher. Sociologist of science Robert Merton came up in the 40s with sort of values, agreed upon values of science. The one that sort of is most relevant to us, he actually called it communism, but communality is just this agreed upon norm of open sharing of knowledge. And I think we could do something to get back to that. There's pretty good evidence for why we might want to worry about this. If you ask researchers, so in the okay, didn't want to do that. Just won't touch it. All right. There we go. Okay, this one's blue for some reason. So if you ask researchers, do you subscribe to norms of data sharing? Everybody says yes, but then if you ask researchers, like, do you actually practice that yourself? Less, somewhere about 60%, but then if you ask them, what do you think other people are doing? It's below 10%. So that's probably people overestimating their own conforming to the norms. And again, if you ask researchers, have you ever failed to report all your dependent measures, collected more data after seeing whether results were significant, failed to report all your conditions, stopped data collection after achieving the desired result, rounded down p-values, et cetera, down to the inner circle of hell, falsifying data, people say yes, that they've done, so like surprisingly large amounts of people say that they've done this and assume that a lot more people are actually doing it even more. So that's sort of just outright fraud or just poor statistical purposes, which honestly, I'd like to believe that's not most of the problem, fraud, but there's just not deliberate problems maybe, but other existing problems, publication bias. So there's evidence that publication bias exists. Effect sizes diminish with sample size. There's a higher fraction of rejected hypothesis tests in social compared to hard sciences. Null results are disappearing over time across all disciplines. And data on the complete set of experiments run, so if you have the universe of studies that were run on a certain topic, you can. There's evidence that 40 percentage points more likely, strong results are 40 percentage more likely to be published and 60 percentage more points more likely to be written up. So, and this publication bias, there's evidence that it exists across all fields, medicine, the social sciences in general, economics, sociology, and political science. So in medicine, you can, because of registries where people have to declare all the studies that they're doing on a certain topic, you can go back after a while and say, okay, of all these studies that we know, this is the universe of studies, how many of those got published? And so this is from Turner et al. In 2008, and they're looking at antidepressant clinical trials, and basically it gets published if it's a positive result, and it doesn't get published if it's a negative result, and this is an RCT with pretty clearly defined treatment, so you might be worried about that. This is this science paper by Franco et al. I just mentioned the results. This is from the timeshare experiments, which is an NSF-funded nationally representative phone survey, and if you want, you can apply to get your set of questions added to the survey. So the folks at Michigan who run the experiment, they have the universe of every set of questions that got put into the survey, and it already passed some hurdle of quality to get into the survey. And then they find that, again, the null results don't get published. They don't even get written up. And the strong results, they all get written up and most of them get published. Of course, there's some endogeneity in what gets written up based on your expectation of what's going to get published, but still, pretty concerning results. In economics, if you, Brodeur et al. Collected z-statistics from several years of the top journals and found this sort of disturbing dip in z-statistics just below the significance cutoff, and they sort of backed it out that 10 to 15% of the marginally significant statistics should actually be on the insignificant side. Same is true, sort of, if you do a caliper test, if you look in a narrow bandwidth on either side of the significance cutoff in top sociological journals and top political science journals, you get the same unlikely to represent the truth outcome. So that's publication bias, that if we only write up or publish significant results and we have no record of the insignificant results, we have no way to tell if our supposedly significant results are real or if they're just the 5% that we should expect due to noise, how statistical testing works. So another related problem is p-hacking. It's not always clear what's p-hacking and what's publication bias, but p-hacking also goes by the names of phishing, researcher, degrees of freedom, specification searching, data mining, data munging, lots of names for it. But this is when flexibility in data analysis allows portrayal of almost anything as below an arbitrary p-value threshold, significance sort of loses its meaning. And this isn't something only evil people do. This is subconscious. There's lots of psychologists in the room who can tell you that humans are really good at motivated reasoning. And so you're going to run a bunch of specifications, and then finally you find one that is that gets you the 0.04. And that's the one that you really wanted to run all along. And that one is best, clearly. And you can pretty easily convince yourself of that because you're human. Evidence of this, there's a great 538 did a great piece on this where depending on how you define political parties and whether you look at the Senate or the House or governors or the president, like you can find sort of whatever result you want in explaining which political party leads to the best economic growth, whether it's, you know, just define your outcomes differently, whether it's unemployment or increase in GDP, you can get any statistically significant results you want. Joe Simmons, Leif Nelson, and Yuri Simonson are great psychologists working in this area. They have this paper about undisclosed flexibility, where they prove using a randomized trial that listening to the Beatles song "When I'm 64" actually makes you younger, because there's enough flexibility in which specifications you run and how you write your models that you can quote unquote prove that. So we view a potential solution to this is registration. So registration is publicly stating the research you'll do and what hypotheses you'll test prospectively. This has near universal adoption in medical randomized trials. It got that way because the top journals, the International Consortium of Medical Journal Editors, basically said, we're not going to publish your RCT unless it's registered. So this has very strong adoption through clinicaltrials.gov. It would be even better if these registries had outcomes, and some types of medical trials are required to report outcomes, but the reporting, it's a very small fraction of them, and the reporting is actually not enforced so strongly. But the NIH last fall has taken steps to sort of strengthen that. So this same sort of registration is taking off in the social sciences. It's relatively new, but if you're an economist doing an RCT, you can register at socialscienceregistry.org. EGAP, which is Experiments in Governance and Politics, that's the political science registry. There's 3IE, which is the International Initiative for Impact Evaluation. If you're doing impact evaluation in developing countries, they've got a registry. And the Open Science Framework, built by the Center for Open Science, has a open format registration system. So you can basically just upload the materials saying these are the hypotheses I'm going to test, hit the register button, and you can create a frozen time-stamped version of your analysis plan and share that when you're ready. But it'll be frozen and timestamped so that you can't edit it, but you get a verifiable timestamp with it. So registrations in the American Economic Association registry started in 2013, and there's over 500 registrations so far. This is still orders of magnitude below clinical trials, but we're happy that it's continually increasing. There's another type of registration, which is design-based publication. This is also called registered reports. I think we sort of overuse the word register in our team, but so I call this design-based publication or results-blind review. That's basically, we move peer review before data gathering results and analysis. So you design a project, and then you submit it to the journal, and then you get reviewed based on the importance of the question and the quality of the design. You get in principle acceptance, and then if you follow through, your null result, whatever you get, would get published, as long as you follow through on the design. So this is, so far 20 journals have done this, a few more have published special issues. Basically, this is what's going on. I think that's an interesting model that's worth testing. Mostly, so far, it's in psychology journals, because a psychologist, Chris Chambers, is the one who developed that model. Real quick, as part of a registration, you can include a pre-analysis plan, which is a detailed layout of the statistical analyses you're planning to include. So this is sort of expected with a medical trial that you're registering with the FDA. But in social sciences, you might be, we encourage sort of more detail where you'd lay out all these things, the description of the sample, the hypotheses to be tested, how you're going to do multiple hypothesis testing, how you're going to group hypotheses together as families, if you are gonna build a formal model, as economists do, include that model, and then remember to archive it. So you include this statistical analysis plan in the registration, so you write this before you do the study. There's examples of these. All these slides are online, by the way, since I'm over time already. But one last thing is that it prevents us from doing this. This is a paper by Casey Glenister and McGill in the Quarterly Journal of Economics, and this is the cherry-picking table. They did a large community-driven development project in Sierra Leone. And community-driven development is, by nature, hard to define, because you let the communities decide what projects they want. So they could have found, because there are so many outcomes that they measure, they could have found that this program that was named GoBifo, they could have found that it weakened institutions, they could have found that it strengthened institutions, but instead, since they had written a detailed statistical pre-analysis plan, they found a big fat zero, and they were under sort of no pressure to cherry pick that into something other than what it was. You could even do this with observational studies, because most research is observational research. There's an example from over a decade ago from economics, where because you know in the US that the government is going to release data on a reliable schedule, before that data comes out, you can say, I'm going to run this specification on next year's minimum wage data, and people will maybe take your results a little more seriously. So why would you want to do this? Because it's good science. You can get a badge. There's some journals are giving badges, and because you could get $1,000 if you go through this pre-registration challenge with the Center for Open Science. That is all.